Good evening, everyone, and thank you for coming. Tonight's concert is titled The Birth of Grace. It is designed to take the listener on a journey from Advent to Christmas. The two works featured tonight, Cantata No. 61 by Johann Sebastian Bach, composed in 1714 as service music for the first Sunday in Advent, and In Terra Pax, a work composed by Gerald Finzi in 1954, which describes a man reflecting back to the very first Christmas and the birth of Christ. We will see that although these two composers varied in their faith, the culminations are two masterpieces that speak to audiences of all nations and creeds. Let us begin by looking at the theological idea of grace. According to Christianity, grace is defined as the free and unmerited favor of God, as manifested in the salvation of sinners and the bestowal of blessings. Some Christian doctrines believe that it is a gift from God that he gave to humanity by sending his son to die on a cross, thus delivering eternal salvation. Theologian and public speaker James Ryle has suggested that grace is the empowering presence of God, enabling you to be who he created you to be and to do what he has called you to do. However, the concept of grace is by no means confined just to Christianity. It is found in other religions as well. Hindu devotional literature is filled with references to grace, stating it is the ultimate key required for spiritual self-realization. The ancient sage Visthaya considered it to be the only way to transcend the bondage of lifetimes of karma, and the Hindu philosopher Madhvatra held that grace was not a gift from God, but rather must be earned. Dr. Umar al-Shakar wrote that paradise is something immense. It is of immense value, and a person cannot earn it by virtue of his deeds alone, but by grace, through the grace and mercy of Allah. Prophet Muhammad once said that none amongst you can get into paradise by virtue of his deeds alone, not even I, but that Allah should wrap me in his grace and mercy. In Judaism, the Hebrew term chen, which states grace is the moral quality of kindness, displaying a favorable disposition. Even within Christianity, there are differing concepts of grace. In particular, Catholics and Protestants use the word in substantially different ways. It has been described as the watershed that divides Catholicism from Protestantism. Catholic doctrine teaches that God has imparted divine grace upon humanity and uses the sacraments to facilitate the reception of his grace, while Protestantism almost universally believes that grace is given by God based on the faith of the believer, which is itself a gift from God. So, how does this relate to tonight's program? It shows that grace can affect people from many different backgrounds, which is transferred to the music of composers who have composed from those same ideals. Johann Sebastian Bach was an extremely devout Protestant who relished in making music because of his faith in God. Gerald Finzi, on the other hand, was an agnostic, descended from Jewish heritage. For two composers whose religious beliefs were so different, they both portrayed the mysterious beauty of the birth of a savior, a person who, according to Christian belief, brought divine grace to all of humanity. Bach's Cantata No. 61, Nun kommt der Heiland, was composed while he was in Weimar in 1714 for the first Sunday in the season of Advent. For those of you who are unaware, when capitalized, Advent refers to the coming of Christ into the world, or the liturgical period of the four Sundays preceding Christmas. It may also refer to the second coming of Christ, but in essence, it means a time of waiting, a time of expectancy, and a time of excitement for the future. Throughout his life, Bach had an unwavering assurance of God's providence in his life. The depth of his trust and faith in the Lord is clearly evident in his compositions. To Bach, all music, sacred and secular, was for the glory of God. He would agree with Protestant leader Martin Luther, who wrote, "Music's only purpose should be for the glory of God and the recreation of the human spirit." At the beginning of his manuscripts, Bach would write I-N-J, In nomine Jesu, in the name of the Lord. He would also write J-J, Jesu Juva, Jesus help me. And he would finally inscribe at the end of every manuscript, S-D-G, Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory. His faith was evident in all areas of his music. The ever-ingenious Bach even created his own personal seal. It is made up of a crown that sits above his intertwined initials. The initials are also mirrored backwards, signifying that Bach had turned from his sins to the saving grace of Christ. The monogram also contains the Greek symbol chi, which stands for the cross, which is intertwined in the initials, signifying that Bach was a cross-bearer, following scripture in the gospel according to St. Matthew. Quote, Matthew says, "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me." Matthew 16, verse 24. As we can see, Bach fully embraced and proudly displayed his beliefs. Throughout his life, Bach endured a multitude of grief and sadness, though. By the age of 10, he was an orphan. His first wife died, leaving him with four young children. In total, 10 of his children died in infancy. He struggled with church leadership and town councils, and at times could be a man with quite a temper. However, Bach learned to depend completely upon God for grace and blessings in his life. Cantata 61 is considered one of his most famous cantatas. It is an example of a reform cantata, which contains small-scale elements of an unstaged opera, such as arias, recitatives, duets, and choruses based on freely composed narrative text. The text for Nun kommt der Heilige Heiland is by author and pastor Erdmann Neumeister, who was the main architect in the development of the Reform cantata genre and became one of Bach's most frequently used librettists. Composed during his tenure in Weimar, the ruling dukes were avid music lovers and Bach became friends with the family. One of whom was Johann Ernst, the younger brother of Duke Ernst August. In 1713, Johann Ernst would frequently travel to Amsterdam and bring back rich collections of Italian music. Bach eagerly began making organ transcriptions and was particularly influenced by Vivaldi's 1712 collection of concertos. The influx of Italian scores became a decisive moment in Bach's musical evolution. From that point on, he would combine his earlier German and French contrapuntal style with Italian operatic characteristics, in particular the use of recitatives and da capo arias. Cantata 61 is also one of the very first compositions in which he began to utilize these new techniques. The opening movement incorporates the first verse of the ancient hymn to St. Ambrose of Milan, Veni Redemptor Gentium, set in the German version adapted by Martin Luther in 1524. The hymn had been used by the Lutheran Church for centuries and was a prominent hymn for the first Sunday in Advent. A modern day equivalent would be, O come Emmanuel. The melody would have been vehemently familiar to the congregation and serve as a relative element before the introduction of the new freely composed music and text by the soloists. The first movement is unique in that it is the first appearance of the French overture style with its characteristic dotted rhythms in Bach's liturgical music. Being a secular genre, the French overture was not a symbol of the church, but instead it was a symbol of the court, monarchy, and wealth. Let's listen to this opening music and the dotted rhythms. Thank you. the text for the following recitatives and arias serves to create a narrative sermon. The tenor recitative informs the congregation that the Savior has come and has accepted us as family despite our feebleness. He continues his narration in the following aria and pleads for Jesus to come to the church and grant them a blessed new year. The aria is filled with Trinity references. In addition to the text being Trinity-based, the 9/8 time signature is made up of three groups of three-note figures. Even the form is comprised of three sections, A, B, A. A da capo aria has an opening section, followed by a contrasting middle section, and concludes with the repeat of the opening material. Let's listen to the da capo aria by the tenor. Effective example of word painting comes in the fourth movement bass recitative. The entire orchestra has pizzicato eighth notes for the entire duration. These represent the knocking that the bass describes in his text. Unlike the triumphant declamatory nature of the tenor libretto, the bass recitative displays vulnerability. The text is from the personal viewpoint of the singer as he stands with trepidation, knocking on the door, awaiting Christ to answer and invite him in to dine with him. It reflects his fear that when his time comes, he will not be worthy to enter into communion with Jesus. The exposed melody of the vocalist reflects the raw vulnerability and the nervousness of the man awaiting his eternal fate, and is heightened by the separated points of the pizzicato orchestra accompaniment. Approaching, but this time focuses on the individual's reaction rather than what Christ will do. Following the bass's worrisome entreaty, the soprano reflects upon the understanding that in order to be invited into the kingdom of heaven, she must first open her heart to the Lord. It is not she that needs to be led into the kingdom, but it is she that needs to open herself to that glory and grace. Again, the da capo form lends itself perfectly to the Trinity theme and contains specific phrases repeated in sets of three, such as, O wie selig werd ich sein, oh how blessed I will be. To conclude the work, Bach uses an unusual truncated final movement that sets only two lines of the chorale text. Even more unusual is the fact that the sopranos are the only part, including the instruments, to have the chorale melody. Usually more instruments and choruses have the chorale melody, but only the sopranos do. The surrounding voices and instruments contain soaring scalar melodies and buoyant bass arpeggios that elaborate the flourished text, "Come, you beautiful crown of joy, do not delay." Here's the final movement. I'll let you wait till the end of the movement to hear the final chord. On to Finzi. In his early 20s, Gerald Finzi was invited to join the bell ringers in the tiny church on Chosen Hill to ring in the new year. Although it was a small church, it was rich in musical heritage and was a favorite hall of Herbert Howells. The purity of the air and the wide vistas of the hillside, this setting made it one of Finzi's most beloved areas. Throughout Finzi's life, war and loss, however, were constant companions. The youngest of four brothers, he was thankfully too young to fight in World War I, but by the age of 18, he had lost his father, his three older brothers, and his beloved music teacher, all of them killed in action. This backdrop of loss caused him to retreat into music and the quiet, protective isolation of the countryside. In addition to his carefully created environment, Finzi was also politically alert. His parents were Jewish, and he saw the continuous persecution of his religious heritage, this happening throughout his entire lifetime. By instinct and reason, he was a pacifist and distrusted dogmas and creeds, which eventually led him to become an agnostic. In 1951, Finzi learned that he was suffering from Hodgkin's disease and had at most 10 years to live. He kept the knowledge within his family and between treatments simply continued to work. In 1954, he was inspired to compose a new work for the string ensemble he had founded called the Newberry String Players. It was originally scored for two soloists, chorist, strings, harp, and one percussionist, which you will hear tonight. He later expanded this for full orchestra for the Three Choirs Festival in 1956. Intera Pax is one of Finzi's final compositions. The roots of its creation can be traced back to that night in his 20s when he was sitting on a hill at the church in Chosen Hill ringing in the new year. He wrote to his dear friend, Ralph Vaughan Williams, that the work was inspired by one remarkable frosty night when he was invited to play with the bell ringers at a beloved church. At midnight, the bells began to sound all across Gloucester Valley. The peace that he felt from being in the countryside and the excitement and prospect of a new year was a feeling that remained with him throughout his entire life and eventually manifested in Intera Pax. For the text, Finzi chose one of his favorite poems by Robert Seymour Bridges titled Noel, Christmas Eve, 1913, subtitled Pax Hominibus Bonae Voluntatis, Peace to Men of Goodwill. The poem had always caught his eye, and in 1954 he decided to set it to music. Bridges' poem portrays a lone man standing on a hill reflecting on the first Christmas and the birth of Jesus. Finzi combines the poem with biblical verses from the Gospel of Luke, in which the angels appear to the shepherds to reveal the birth of the awaited Savior. Intera Pax is subtitled A Christmas Scene, and is described in his program notes. He describes in his program notes that the nativity scene becomes a vision seen by a wanderer on a dark and frosty Christmas Eve, transporting the scene to our own familiar landscape and our own time period. Finzi adored his native English countryside and placed the biblical text into the pastoral, and the placement, I should say, the placement of the biblical text into the pastoral setting of the English countryside falls in line with the rich tradition of English Romanticism. Each of the soloists portrays a role in the text. The baritone is cast as the man standing alone on a hillside in Bridge's poem, and the soprano as the angel from the Gospel of Luke, who speaks to the shepherd saying, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy." Finzi uses the orchestration to paint a variety of musical colors. To open the work, he uses an iconic bell-tolling motive of two-sequence descending fourths in the low strings. Used by a number of composers throughout the centuries, the bell motive is often associated with Baroque composer Johann Pachelbel's Canon in D. If you've been to a wedding, you know what that is. The motive evokes in the listener images of church bells chiming in the distance, and the audience is transported to the contemplative Christmas Eve opening scene of Bridge's poem. Let us listen to this opening. Just stunning. As the baritone enters, he recalls the first Christmas and asks when the shepherds were marveling at the music, was it the voice of the angels or the bright stars singing? Finzi uses the bell toll motive to transition to the next scene, where the chorus enters with the words of St. Luke. Throughout the work, the chorus acts as the narrator and sings only the biblical text and the story of the shepherds. It is noteworthy that Finzi does not include the verses regarding the virgin birth. He focuses instead on the pastoral scene and how it can be compared to his own experiences in the countryside. Messenger arrives as the voice of the soprano soloist. Her words, "Fear not," are sung three times as if to soothe them. The vocal line is authoritative with its descending fifth interval, which the orchestra introduces just before she enters.
Thank you.
The climax brings a triumphant return of the bell motif as the chorus sings in glorious canonic imitation, doubled by the orchestra, "Glory be to God in the highest." As the climax subsides, the chorus delivers their final and ultimate message, "And on earth peace, goodwill toward men." The strings transition us back, and the baritone returns to Bridges' poetry, taking us back to Finzi's New Year's Eve memory on Chosen Hill. In essence, the words could have been written specifically for Finzi. He would only have 2 more years before succumbing to complications from Hodgkin's disease. Yet, through these final years, Finzi remained true to his love of music and those close to him. He was a survivor, through and through. He had lived through 2 world wars, experienced the loss of family, of friends, and observed the persecution of his Jewish heritage. Despite all that he had faced in his lifetime, Interopax was a deeply personal reflection of his views on life. There is a remarkable serenity to the composition, and despite his agnosticism, Finzi was able to draw comfort from a Christian message. As Bridges' poem says, the old words came back to me by the riches of time, mellowed and transfigured. He was able to connect with the text on a level aside from the dogmatic interpretation and see a universal message. At heart, Finzi was a pacifist who loved the meditative quiet of the countryside and believed that each human being possessed the capacity for good. It was something that he himself sensed and was drawn to all those years ago at the church on Chosen Hill on New Year's Eve, listening to the cries of bells when, in Robert Bridges' words, he stood on the hill, hearkening in the aspects of eternal silence. For all of Finzi's agnosticism, he loved his family Christmas traditions. Their family Christmas traditions, when they would carol around the village with his friends. Most of all, he loved the time of silence and the turn of the year. The symbol of rebirth it brought touched him very, very deeply. Peace on earth is what Finzi wished for most passionately. Interopax is unpretentious in its beauty and was never a commissioned work. It was simply something that came from his own impulse and is a reflection of his paradise in pastoral England, his quest for roots and continuity and of uniting the past to the present. To me, one of the most striking elements about Christmas and the birth of Jesus is that although it is a joyous time of year, it inevitably leads to the season of Lent, to Holy Week, and to Christ's crucifixion. The season is filled with mixed emotions. It's a time when we remember the holidays of our youth, and if we are older, think of those who are no longer sitting with us at the dinner table. Finzi's final melody for the soloist is gorgeous, is a gorgeous lyrical melody that floats along in a hopeful manner. Yet, at the same time, it is reminiscent and very, very sad. In life, we have so many joyful memories, but there is always the inevitability of winter and the twilight of life. How we enter into this season is a reflection of how we have lived. Regardless of whether one believes that Jesus of Nazareth was the Son of God, the lessons that he left behind as an intellectual are his legacy. His birth brought forth a new way to live life, one of grace and love. That is why two composers from such different religious and ideological backgrounds can indeed find common ground in their music. They both believe that mankind has the capacity for incredible compassion, particularly during the season of Advent and New Year. Above all, it is a time to remember the joy of fellowship with one another and the love that we share between us as human beings. Thank you again for coming. I hope you enjoy tonight's concert. Enjoy the show.